Blog Talk Radio, the world's largest online radio network.
Welcome to another SHRA radio show. My name's Steve. My co-host Carl's out there somewhere. Say hello, Carl.
Hello. How's everybody doing this week?
Doing good, doing good. Well, we had another record-setting show last week. We had a tad under 8,000 listeners for last week, Carl. So the show's getting popular, which is a good thing. That means people are listening. We're not just talking to each other.
Well, you know, if I could get popular, that would be really cool.
Yeah, well, we're going to start working on it. I mean, last month we had 18,000 listeners, and I think this month we'll be on track for over 20. So show's starting to really take off. But I want to start them all the same. I want to thank our sponsors that are helping us as we speak, is AD Performance Carburetors. Our guest tonight will be Kevin Brown from Moroso and Competition Engineering. I tried to get Rick on the phone, but he didn't get back to me in time. So we'll keep working on Rick. We'll see if we can't get him on here to say hello to us. Race Fittings out of Miami. Media One, who backs a lot of X275 races. You see that logo everywhere. TRZ Motorsports, the same deal. Everywhere you see an X275 race or a G-body race or any kind of stock suspension, you'll see TRZ's logo out there. Rob down there at Chisholm Performance, we're going to get him on here to talk about his 10.5 build. He's got it going good. I guess the car's coming along nice. We'll see when he's going to get it out. We'll have to get Rob back on the show, see what's new with him. And our charity of choice this year is DRAW, Drag Racing Association of Women, who, with all the stuff you read on all these forums, has probably been very busy, unfortunately. And then I got to thank our websites that we spam. Oh, and Murray Speed and Custom, of course, Carl always reminds me. I can't do this without Murray Speed and Custom. Without Mark's help, we wouldn't be doing this, so big shout out to Murray Speed and Custom for giving me the time and the place and backing our races and helping us out with our stuff. We got the yellowbullet.com, Mining's Board. We spam that a lot. Competition Plus, Need to Speed also. Pro Mods US, DragRaceResults.com, South Florida Drag Racers Forum, X275.net, DMCRacing.com, Duck X Productions. And that's the people we spam all the time, Carl.
Yeah, I kind of do my share of it, but, you know, I got to do that in between all my wheel data that I work on all day long.
Yeah, yeah, you're a busy boy.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know. We got some races coming up. Palm Beach has got some stuff coming up. They got a Street Legends Domestic versus Import put on by Biz Speed. These guys are real good. They do a great job out there. Mike and I went out there the last time. That place was packed. They have a bikini contest. They have drifting. They have drag racing. They have a car show. They have bands. I mean, it's a great time. That's a lot of fun. Then we got the third annual Players Ball. Where is this located? DJ, Georgia Car and Sound. I guess this is in Georgia. Let's see where it is. I got this flyer in front of me. Douglas Motorsports Park, DMP. Where's that at, Carl?
That would be in Douglas, Georgia.
There you go. See, I said it was Georgia. And
good
then
guess.
Palm Beach has got Hot Rod Sunday coming up, and that is August 12th. You remember those races, Carl, in August at Hot Rod Sunday?
Yeah, you could. It was so damn hot, man. I mean, you could fry an egg right on the starting line. It was unbelievable. But you know what? We all went. We just loved it, and it was never too hot to race.
Well, we used to have a blast at that. But like you said, if you dropped an egg on the asphalt at Palm Beach back then, you'd have a roasted egg, a boiled egg or something. It was so freaking hot.
Yeah.
God, it was
like
some hot days.
Up.
Yeah, exactly. There you go. And then the all-new NMCA, West Pomona, California. That's August 17th to the 19th. And then we got
Very cool.
Ultimate Outlaw Shootout Series presented by Mickey Thompson at Milam Dragway. The Pritchard brothers are going to give it hell up there.
Yeah, it's going to be
a great
group
of guys, huh?
Oh, yeah. Them guys are so much fun, and you know, they got Matters going to be handling the microphone up there. And, you know, Mickey Thompson has always been involved. Well, since Tommy and I were working together at Mickey Thompson, we pretty much, you know, feel like Milan's kind of like one of our home tracks. And so great place to have a race at, good folks up there. We've had them on before, Deneen and the bunch. So, you know, great place, and for Nate and his brother. It's their once-a-year party time. They're going to come out and tear it up, and I'm sure there'll be plenty of hangovers to be discussed after that.
Oh, yeah, they throw on a hell of a party.
That's that. Did I give the date on that? That is the 18th. That's coming fast.
And
then we got Mayhem, August 18th at Millham Dragway. That's something else they're putting on, 32 car, 12,000 to win. Oh, I don't know what the hell that is. Mayhem at Millen Dragway, August 18th, the same day. I guess they got a bunch of shit going on.
It's Milan. I'm gonna beat that into you.
Milan. Okay, there we go, Milan. Then we got the Poker Bash coming up. That's, I got to read all these flyers. That's at MIR, Maryland International Raceway. And what day is that? That's the... Man, you gotta search these flyers for information sometimes. They need to make the dates bigger and stuff. Well, you can call MIR at 301-884-RACE and get the dates for that, because I can't find it on the flyer. Oh, Christ. Saturday and Sunday. I found that. We're going to move on to the UBLY All Out. August 17th and 18th, Gambler's Race. Then we got Heads Up Racing by Holcomb Race Engines, Holly Team Motorsports. That is at Milan Dragway. Well, they got a lot of stuff going on up there, huh? They're pretty busy. That's August 18th. What are they going to do on that weekend? And we got The Rock is having a... Well, some kind of motorcycle drag race. And then you got the Yellow Bullet Nationals coming. That's going to be a big race, huh? Mining's race is going to be huge.
Yellow Bullet is always a great, great, great race. I mean, you get the Cecil. They put the new pavement, the new cement down there, so it's fast. And it's just, you know, it's got everything. It's just out. It's not like a huge facility, but it's big enough, you know, and it's a great, great time. And, of course, you know, in the Northeast, all the guys come down, and, you know, the guys from the South come up, and it's kind of a great meeting ground. And, you know, my hat's off to Jim and, of course, Monty, who I think the world of, and put on a great event. So that'll be a good one. And
yeah, that's August 31st.
Maryland. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, they're getting pumped up, no question. I mean, they're down to the 20-something day range, and, you know, you look on the bullet, and they got the countdown going.
Yeah. You got some nice payouts, too. $10,000 to win in 10-5, $5,000 for runner-up in 10-5. And then you go into semis, you made $1,000. Outlaw Drag Radio is $5,000, $2,000, and $1,000. X275 is $5,000, $2,000, and $1,000. A50 Index is $5,000, $2,000. Ultra 275 is $1,500 and $500. Outlaw Big Tires $2,500. Top Sportsman's $2,000. It's got some violin races for $1,000. Golf cart races $1,500. There's a lot of shit going on up there. Monty's gonna be a busy boy up there running around.
Yep, and they sell all those new T-shirts, and I mean, it's just nonstop. Plus, everybody cooks, and you know, I mean, I really love, you got Harry over there, the 850 cars, and. You know, all kinds of great people, Bill and Wendy Mitchell will be there with their 10-5 car. Just kind of did a little Facebooking with them today. Awesome, awesome race, you know. It'll be a good time for everybody.
I already got my T-shirt. My T-shirt and my decals I ordered. I got them in.
Nice.
Yeah, nice T-shirt, too. I like it.
Oh, yeah.
And then in September, you got the September Tour Remember, the No Mercy Race 3. I wonder who's putting that on, where that is.
That would be Duck X Productions. And obviously Donald has always put on the best of the best for drag radio. He's a true proponent of the drag radio. Everybody's been giving him a lot of heat lately, but I don't really care because he's a good friend as well. And, you know, he works very hard at these races, him and Jim. And, yeah, they might have a unique way of going about their promotions, but I love them anyway. And tons of cars, heads-up cars, you know, 300-400. That place at South Georgia Motorsports Park is packed full. And, you know, they feed everybody. And it's, again, a very, very entertaining and competitive race. The racetrack is top-notch. Always got the prep down. So it'll be a great event as well.
Yeah, yeah, it's definitely going to be the September to remember. There you go. And tonight our guests are going to be, I have Kevin Brown on, talking about the cooling system products from Moroso, and they got some really nice new stuff out, water pumps and brackets. Makes it really easy to mount an electric water pump, run an alternator, power steering pump, whatever you want, they got brackets for it. We're going to have Gary French on. Big Low and Jay Burns, they are from Grudge Inc. They put on some grudge races down here in Florida, County Line, and they got a big one coming up at I-60. So we're going to have him on talking about that a little bit and talking about their association they put together to promote grudge racing at a track instead of on the street.
Well, I'm all for that. Obviously, the safety is much more... you know, paramount when you're on the racetrack. You got people there that can help you if you get in a jam. And plus, you know, it's even and fair square. You got a prepared deal, and you're got plenty of witnesses.
Yeah, well, they're like everybody else. You know, they just want a place to race. They want a safe place to race, and they want to have fun. You know, they don't want to get bothered by the law. And a lot of tracks frown on grudge racing. But there's money to be made there. If you put on a nice event and promote it correctly, you'll fill the stands. You get a bunch of cars out there. Everybody will have fun.
Well,
that's,
you know,
all you can ask for.
The way
for.
I look at it, you know, racing is racing. I don't care if you're grudge, heads up, if you're class racing, if you're bracket racing. I really don't really care. I just want to see people race. And,
right.
You know, yeah, they get into the gambling part, the money, the dollar bills, the $50 bills, whatever, the back and forth. And that's like, to me, that's free entertainment. That's just part of the deal. And if you're really sly, you can slide in there and make you some money. So it can be kind of interesting. And I can sit back and just watch. But I know some folks that get in there and dice it up and come away with a couple hundred pounds extra for the weekend. Not a bad deal.
No, it's always a lot of fun. You know, it's like a party and a race broke out. You can go out there, if the track treats you right, you can barbecue, you can have a good time. Everybody just has fun.
Yep. Cool stuff.
Yeah, it really is. We have them down here at Palm Beach and County Line, and they're a blast. I love going out to them. I bring my car out all the time. You know, I can go out there and
just
I can talk all the crap I want, and then I can go race. It's pretty cool.
Leave your wallet at home there, big guy.
Yeah, well, I don't talk a lot of crap.
That's what you reserve your Tuesday nights for, right? Talking crap.
Yeah, yeah.
Anyway, you know, this last weekend there was a lot of racing going on, and kind of in my world out there in NHRA land and ADRL land, and I wanted to say a word about all the girls that are kicking butt here lately. I mean, you know, it's still this National Dragster right here at my desk. If you look at the July 27th issue on page 9, that picture, and page 94, 92, something like that, I don't know. It's an old picture of Seattle, and Courtney Force is in it with John Force, and I'm actually in it too, and kind of brought to my attention by some friends. And she, you know, accomplished something that only people can dream about, and that is she ran Nitro Funny Car to the win at a national event in Seattle, and that's awesome. And alongside her, you know, there was another girl in the winner's circle. And so for Erica Enders, you know, she's a very good friend of mine. I've been friends with her dad for years and years. And, of course, Richard, her fiancé, his dad are very close acquaintances as well. So, I mean, my hat's off to her. There was no fluke involved. You know, she won her second race, and I told her on – we texted just today, and I just told her, I said, you know, there's a lot more to come. You got a great hot rod rundown. She was something. She was knocking them down. And, you know, the Cognazzi power, and builds those cars up there. you know, Todd Beavis, just building great stuff, and that's just awesome. And I'm not, I don't have nothing bad to say against Greg Anderson or Jason Line or any of the other competitors. I love all of them, and they all know that. I've been working with them all for years and years, but I think it's pretty awesome that these young gals can come up and learn a trade and figure out how to get these cars from A to B and win races. So that was really cool. Also, hats off to Steve Torrens for winning Top Fuel. You got to love that as well. But, you know, another cool thing that's happened this weekend was Shannon Jenkins winning Pro Nitrous at the ADRL. They had a really great crowd, which I was really glad to see at Charlotte. And, you know, it worked out really well. Triple B took home the win, the black Mustang in 10-5. And you know, he's a Mickey Thompson guy. And, of course, we had Chris Holbrook in the Supercar Showdown that runs his Mickey Thompson radials, and Bo Butner as well. So both those guys run on Mickey Thompson tires, and that's kind of cool. And then, of course, Doug Riester, a guy that shows up to the racetrack with a 28-foot trailer in a pickup truck and whoops everybody's butt, and that's kind of cool too. So, you know, between that, Tim Tindall winning, the other half of the Frankie Taylor bunch down there out of Texas. Oh, and speaking of Texas, you know, I got to say one thing about an acquaintance of one of our beloved race teams down in Texas, Kenny Hubbard. We kind of call him the fat Chinese guy, but he's been kind of upset a little bit lately, especially with Tommy, about not giving him no love for being the fastest drag radial car on the planet out there. And so, you know, he's gone 426. He got the big screw on his blue Camaro, and he's definitely fast. Definitely one of the fastest there ever was. So we got to shout out and give some love to Kenny Hubbard this week, because he's not feeling the love. So between that, the NMCA was down at Bowling Green, and that was one of those weather deals where it was, you know, raining, not raining, up and down, kind of crazy. But shout out to Eric LaFerriere out of way up in the northeast there, kind of outside of Boston. He drives a car owned by a friend of mine out of Kansas City. Malibu twin turbo big block car built up at what's that place up in the northeast. They build great race cars. Hats off to Eric for that bill, and then of course Clint Harrison with his Ken Duttwalen prepared GTO was at the head of the pack there in the pro street category, whooping up on old Chris. So that was, but there you go. That brings kind of everything into possession on the results for the weekend. It was kind of cool. Dan Baskin won pro stock down there, and Jason Lee, who always dominates in the drag radial deal, won his deal. And I didn't get any of the open comp or any of the other stuff dialed in. There was a Doug Duell special right they do for the South pro stock. This, that, and the other. Some gal won that deal, which is kind of cool. So anyway, that pretty much sums it up. They had some of that Division One deal. None of my heroes won, so, you know, blah, blah, blah. Oh, and the very last that I'll tell you is that Super Pro Challengers we talked about a couple of weeks ago, Brian Fulk, the guy actually had a...
Hey, Carl, you're breaking up a little bit. Still there?
Can you hear me?
Also, yeah, there you go, there you go. Much better. You're breaking up a little bit.
I don't know what's going on.
I got to ask you a question. Did you see any of the standings or the run sheets for the ADRL?
Yeah.
In the Pro Mod class, we had one of our one of the guys that helped us found the SHRA, Spiros Lagakis, was running his red Camaro out there. I was wondering how he did.
I didn't notice.
I don't know who was driving for him. He wasn't driving.
Okay, well, that was new.
Well, breaking up again. Yeah. I'll have to find out how he did. And also, I talked to Sean Ash, he was up at the NMCA, and he lost to Jason Lee. So he went to his first finals, and he lost to Jason Lee. All right, I think we lost you, Carl. I'm going to give you a call back. All right, I think we lost Carl. Let's call Carl right back. We're going to call him back right now. Let's see if we can get him back on a clean line here. I don't know what happened to Carl. He said he told me he already ate, so I'm sure he's not eating. Let's see what happened. We're dialing. Let's see if we can get him on here. Oh, there, and then he went into the... Let's see if we can get him back on. Hey, Carl, you back on with us?
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, we can hear you now. You're like that guy. You need to call that guy.
Yeah. I don't even know where I left off now. I'm all flustered, you know. I just all of a sudden went beep, and I still got three bars, you know. My little superior devices, Tommy calls it, at three bars, so I don't know what's going on.
Well, we're getting close to the Chris Matters show. We got about 2 minutes before Chris is going to get on here and tell us what he's thinking about this week. That should be interesting to see what Chris has to say. And then after Chris, we're going to call and get Kevin Brown on here from Moroso. And then after Kevin, we're going to go into our grudge guys. We'll get them on here and see what's going on in the grudge world. So I don't know if Mike's got a countdown going for Chris or what. But you got any idea what he's talking about, Carl?
No, I was kind of giving him a little grief today, trying to get him stirred up, and I never heard back from him. I didn't get back on. I got occupied. I just kind of messed around at lunchtime a little bit, so who knows? But you know, whatever it is, it's going to be good.
Yeah, I'm sure he's always interesting. Got to hear what he's got to say. But I hear his music playing. That means we've got less than 30 seconds before Chris is on here telling us what he thinks. Let's see what he's got to say, Carl.
I can hardly wait.
Yeah, it'd be funny. Oh, he's this.
Going on, fellas? How are we doing down there today?
Good. How's everything going, Chris? How's everything
going? It's going good. Blaring on my ear.
little
recap. Had a busy week up here. We had Wednesday night, War on Wheels at Bud's Creek. So we had Run What You Brung Pro Mods, and then we had Run What You Brung on 28th or 275s on a Wednesday night. So... you know, we had an interesting night there. I saw Chuck Walsh ran a 391 at 199 and a half mile an hour, so that's put a 10.5 record at Bud's Creek right there. And he was in the finals against Steve Drummond. It was Walsh ran a 391 and Drummond ran a 400 with an O in the semis. So the two of them were supposed to meet in the finals, but we had some lightning coming through, and so we put the race on hold to unplug the timing system, and then had some rain come through, and they just weren't going to get anything in, so they ended up splitting. And then Ricky Fox ran a 460 flat on 275s in his Black Outlaw drag radial car with the get the 730 cubic inch Fulton in it. So some impressive times for those guys that were running. So we did that on Wednesday, and then Friday we had a little Outlaw drag radial action with our regular monthly point series, and Ricky Fox is the current reigning champion, and it was him and Francis in the finals. And Ricky got the best of them on that deal. So Ricky's still leading the points there. We got X275 coming up this Friday. So just a couple of days, we'll do some racing, and then like you guys said, headed out to Milan Dragway, not Milan, it's not Italy, and so we're going to do Nate's deal. You know, everybody's thinking about coming. Make sure you come out on Thursday. We're going to have a little party down at the Irish pub there, and, you know, I had a good time last year beating up the punching bag machine, and then people want different directions for either more party or head back to the track, and then they got testing on Friday, and I guess they're going to have something Friday night, and then racing all day Saturday, and then they got the bonfire, and Deneen and everybody else up there at the drag strip, they got you know, all the good food and the beers and the jello shots and all the good stuff. So it's always a good time. And then I'm not sure who organized or what organization is putting on, but I know I think it's Panetta is putting together a big grudge race where they're all putting some money in, and they're trying to have a $12,000 winner-take-all grudge race the same weekend as Nate's deal. You know, a bunch of these guys down south that they grudge race, they class race, they really don't care. They just, you know, like you said, Carl, they're guys that want to get in and they'll put it in the beams, and they don't care if it's a, you know, if it's a grudge race or a class race or whatever, man. So they get in there and they mix it up, and, you know, Zabo was like, yo, I want to get in, and, you know, a bunch of the grudge racers are too scared to run him. So, you know, we'll give a little shout out for old Zabo right there, because he ain't scared of none of them. He said he'll get in there and put in the beams. And, you know, of course, somebody tried to talk smack and said something about hossing the gas. And he said, you let me in the field and I'll show you hossing the gas. So, you know, we'll give some of the class racers a little love. Those guys down south don't mess around. And, you know, they don't want to sit with class racers because people know what they run. And Zabo basically called him out and said, well, that means that you know you're slow because you know you can't beat me. So they're trying to do that little thing. And then going to take weekend after that, the Jet Wars, the IHRA Pro-Am is at Buds Creek for 3 days, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and Saturday afternoon is the Jet Wars at MIR. They got Jet Funny Car, Jet Dragsters, Jet Car, and they got Bob Motes is making his return to Buds Creek. He hadn't been there in almost 5 years, and of course he had the big fire a couple years ago, and it was away for that, but this is his first time back, and he actually holds the track record there for a jet-powered vehicle, so it's been a long time, so we'll see what he can do, and then they got fireworks and stuff like that. So if you're into the Jet Wars and, Bunny Burkett and a bunch of the nostalgic funny cars will be there, and then they have the fuel altered and the front-engine dragsters and stuff like that, so it's a good time if you like that kind of thing, you got that going on, and then, of course, we're doing the thing at Cecil, and I know that my time's up, so I'm going to let you guys go, but I am going to do this. I'm going to take 30 seconds here, and I'm gonna get really serious for a minute. There's a guy who races at Cecil who was involved in a pretty bad car accident, and as it stands right now, things are not looking very good for him, and so he's in the hospital, and he could use prayers. So I'm going to go ahead and ask that you guys, take 15 or 20 seconds, and we'll go quiet for a few minutes. And if you're into that sort of thing, you want to say some prayers for him and his family and the doctors and the nurses and all the medical staff that are looking for his best interest. So, you know, we're all in this to have fun and stuff like that. But at the end of the day, you know, not seeing a guy at a racetrack is a bad thing. So I'll go ahead and I'll get off here and I'll listen in, and like I said, if you're into that, you can send some prayers up for Mike. Thanks, guys.
Well, there you go. We had a few seconds of silence for him, and hopefully he does okay. So all we can do is pray and hope. And I'm going to tell you guys one more time. It's a Milan. It's not a Milan. It's a Milan. I don't know what language you guys are speaking over there, but from where I'm coming from, it's a Milan, okay? Don't want to give me no hard time. I'll send Joey a bag of donuts over to visit. You know what I'm saying?
All right, Father Guido, we got you.
Yeah, you don't want to see a Joey bag of donuts or Vinny Nonecker show up at your door. That's all I'm going to say. Bring it a horse ahead, it's all over.
Joey bag of donuts actually lives in Huntington Beach, and he drives a Mercedes. You got to watch out for him.
Well, Carl, let's give Kevin a call. Let's see if we can get Kevin on the line here. I see he's been waiting patiently for us.
It's going to take a while because I'm looking at this website here. This is obviously Moroso.com. And when you start looking at cooling system, these guys got from soup to nuts.
Oh, yeah.
That you need, you know, from the, you know, the air bleeds to the water pumps all the way down to the spacer kit. So these guys got it all. And as I've always said, Moroso always has been one of my favorite product lines. And these guys know how to represent racing in the highest fashion, so I can't wait to hear what he's got to say.
Well, I think he's on phone. Let's see if we can get him on here. Let's see if we can get Kevin online. Hey, Kevin, you're online with Carl and Steve?
Steve, what's going on?
Hey, Kevin, how are you? You're on SHRA Radio with Carl, Mike, and Steve, myself. How are you today?
Very good. How's it going, guys?
Going good. We were just talking about some upcoming races and stuff, and we're going to talk a little bit about the Moroso cooling products because these guys come out with a brand new water pump, which we're going to get into some detail on. But I don't know if anybody's ever looked at the Moroso catalog. It's categorized by product, and it's even color-coded, so even the simplest minds can find the stuff they're looking for.
Yeah, we try to make it simple, Steve.
Yeah, that way I can use it. Now, you know, I notice these guys are still doing the aluminum water pumps and aluminum water pump spacers. I'm surprised they still sell with all the technology into the electric water pumps. And I laugh every time I see an electric water pump drive kit. Because when I was a kid and you were building a car, that's how you know you had a race car when you had one of them on it.
Yeah, I got to tell you, Steve, our 63750 style water pump drive kits, they're actually a pretty good seller for us still, and it's surprising me to this day how many we sell.
Yeah, it's amazing, huh? And you still do that fancy, the 63 539s, the polished front water pump for show cars and stuff, real neat looking piece?
We used to do that right up until relatively recent, I believe. But yeah.
Still in the catalog.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And you got the air bleeds for guys that have problems with they get air trapped in the system. They got an air bleed they can screw in to help bleed out the air.
I'll tell you what, Steve. That air bleed kit is actually a very, very nice feature. I use it all the time, even on my personal stuff, especially when trying to fill the coolant system, because I use that as a purge valve, and it really does a pretty good job getting most of the air out of the system. I mean, 'cause it can be pretty troublesome sometimes.
Well, just so guys know, when you mount that, you want to mount that as high as possible, correct?
Yeah, it depends on the type of system that you have, but absolutely, when you're trying to fill something, I mean, absolutely, when you're trying to fill the coolant system, depending on the type of system that you have, you want the air bleed valve to be one of the highest portions of the coolant system, so that you can extract all the air out of the coolant system, so you don't develop any hot pockets or steam pockets in the system.
Right. And you got every kind of radiator cap available, from 6 pounds to 33 pounds.
Yeah, the radiator caps are a very nice deal. I mean, we have the typical low pressure drag race radiator caps in 6 to 8 pounds, or the any coolant system that isn't very, very robust. But when you have a lot of cylinder heads you kind of get a little thin on the water jacket sometimes, you want to run a lower radiator cap pressure on that thing, all the way up to the higher pressure cooling systems that you'd see in more of a modern day endurance type engine.
And then you got radiator hose drain kits, and you got filler neck kits, where you can adapt different size hoses. So if you're running a conventional type water pump fitting, and you got a small racing Scirocco type radiator, there's no need to go crazy looking for a hose. You can buy one of those filler necks, mount it up high. They got the billet head on them, so they're a good piece, and that'll help you fix a lot of stupid little issues.
Oh, no question. We pretty much have like just about everything you need for plumbing your race car. We try to make things as simple and straightforward as possible.
You got a lot. I see your water necks. You still do the cast ones like you did years ago, but you got a mm-hmm. whole lot of billet ones out that look really nice stuff.
Yeah, I mean we have the cast ones out. I mean a lot of the stuff really depends on what kind of budget you're trying to race within, and we've got stuff for everybody. The cast stuff obviously is a little less lower price point for people, and the billet stuff is a little bit more robust and a little higher price point, and obviously has the bling to go along with it.
Yeah. Now, I wanted to get into these billet electric water pumps you have.
Sure.
Tell us a little bit about the pumps. Give us a little background into the pumps. How'd they come about? Because you had electric water pumps for years.
Oh, yeah. We've had the electric water pumps for a long, long time. Ultimately, these are the culminations of, 20, 25 years worth of experience in the electric water pump business. Whereas we've taken and, put our resources into development, and we've developed some new water pumps and made some new, some changes into the water pump line. Ultimately, what we've done is we've increased the efficiency of the impeller design. We've increased the efficiency of the electric motors. We've kind of used our resources and made the electric motors so that the electric water pump housings on all of the new build electric water pumps they're indexable, so you can change the housing clocking location every 90 degrees. So
yeah,
if you want to, it's a real nice feature when you want to plumb your cooling system and the inlet of the radiators on the right side and you need to change the inlet of the pump to match. You don't have to.
Yeah, you look at some of these turbo and supercharged cars where they got the superchargers where they got that crankshaft drive assembly and all. That's a big feature to be able to move the water pump around and reroute that hose away from all that.
Oh, there's no question about it. I mean, with the new people running pro chargers and superchargers
mm-hmm.
and turbos, the plumbing in the front of the engine can get really, really tight and really restricted. We've got some different solutions for that as well. We've also got a remote water pump that's just absolutely stellar. It's very compact, relatively lightweight, and you can pretty much mount it anywhere. And all these systems will operate on 12 and 16 volt systems.
Yeah, I see. I'm looking at your 2012 catalog, and there's a wealth of information in there on the pumps.
Yep.
Now, the application's pretty large, too. You got big block, small block Chevy, small block Chrysler, big block Chrysler. You also have the new Magnum motors.
Yep, LS motors
the Fords,
as well.
Yeah, the Fords, and then you got the adapters, and you got an LS pump.
Mm-hmm.
So you got really good coverage on that.
Yeah, we got excellent coverage. We try to cover all the bases. I mean, those are all the major popular applications that we see out there. They seem to be moving pretty well, and I'll tell you what, they perform exceptionally well. Not to mention they're also very lightweight.
Couple really neat features. The adapters are no longer pipe thread; they're O-ring Boss.
Yeah, absolutely. Part of the upgrade functions on the development side of these things were. What we did is we took a look at all the deficiencies that we've had in these pumps over the years, and we've tried to eliminate them, kind of streamline the product line a little bit, and make everything as efficient as possible. And the inlet fittings on these pumps, Steve, are all O-ring Boss fittings. They're all Army Navy, O-ring type fittings,
right.
And they work really well. We try to eliminate as many pipe threads as we possibly can, that's a given leak sooner or later.
Now, I know the answer to this because you and I worked on it with one of my customers. I'm on one of them electric water pumps, and I want to run a vacuum pump and an alternator. Do I have to fabricate a bracket?
No, you don't have to fabricate a bracket. We've come up with some really trick applications with our vacuum pumps and alternator mounting kits that we have for these things. you know, and we've come out with kits that mount, you know, specifically with our water pumps and some of the popular brands as well.
Right, you got a vast selection of them. They work really good. They're great looking. They're stout. They're strong. Very easy to install. And with a little modification. Now, these are designed for the smaller case alternators. Was it the 93 millimeter? Is that what they call that?
Yeah, the 93 millimeter Denso style case alternator. Yep.
Right, right.
Yep.
But I'll tell you, with a little modification, you can put on that 98, which goes up to 100 amps.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah, we've got one on there, and it's working.
Mm-hmm. And it's working pretty well, I'm quite sure.
The guy's happy.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. The new alternator and the new alternator and vacuum pump mounting brackets, they're built to integrate into the new water pumps and the water pump housings. It really, really cleans up the front of the engine, and it makes packaging so much nicer. It's they're very, very ingeniously simple design, which makes it very elegant to use.
Yeah, well, the KISS method, keep it simple, stupid, and it works.
I'm a firm believer of that. I try not to get too fancy.
Yeah, don't overcomplicate it. Now, all this stuff, they can see pictures of all this on the website, right? www.moroso.com?
Absolutely, absolutely. All that stuff is up there. You can do a keyword search or a product number search, and it'll take you right to the product.
And what's the tech line number, Kev, so we can give it out to these guys?
Sure. The tech line number is 203-458-0542. And the other number we have for it is 203-458-0546.
Now, let's talk a little bit about measuring water flow and stuff. I see companies 30 gallons an hour, 40 gallons an hour, 50 gallons an hour, 7,000 gallons an hour. How do you rate your water pumps?
Well, one of the things that we do is that we took into account the entire cooling system, and for each one of the water pumps, we put them in its native environment. And what I mean by native environment, on a firing engine with the entire cooling system attached to it. The cooling system in this case being a radiator, upper radiator hoses, lower radiator hoses, etc. And they were measured on the engine at level with coolant system pressure. So it has to go, the flow numbers are actually flow numbers in a real-world environment going through the radiator, blocks, cylinder heads, manifold, et cetera. So when we took into consideration the testing side of this thing, we really wanted to be as durable as possible and measure real-world environment.
Well, that's important because anybody can throw numbers up, but to actually have a real number of what it's doing when it's flowing through the block, that's important. Yeah.
Absolutely. More often than not, Steve, people take, the people that are posting really, really high outlet flow numbers on these things, they're pressurizing the inlet on these things, and they have a large column of water that's acting as a pressure head to kind of bolster the numbers a little bit.
You take an American-made fan or an Italian-made fan, Spall, for instance, you take one of these Chinese fans. They both say they flow 1,000 CFM. You hook them up to the battery and set them on the counter, and you can hear the Chinese fan slow down. Now, in a wind tunnel, it might flow 1,000 CFM. You put it in front of a radiator, there's no way it's going to flow 1,000 CFM with a restriction.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. That's like I said, we try to do these things. We try to do the flow numbers and testings in as native environment as we possibly could make it. We couldn't think of anything better than in the real world application.
There you go. And you're using all stainless steel shaft.
Oh yeah, yeah. The impeller, everything aluminum is anodized clear aluminum. Everything else is all stainless steel hardware on this unit. It's really a top-notch piece.
Right, even the bolts, the mounted are stainless, so it's not like they cut corners on anything.
No, there's no corners been cut on these units. They're a very, very top-notch piece, and We're so happy with these things. We're even an NHRA contingency sponsor on these these water pumps.
And that goes back. There's two ways to make it. You can either make it better or make it so it can sell cheaper. And obviously, these are made to be better, and you're getting what you pay for.
Mm-hmm.
So they're not made to sell by price. They're made to sell by function and do what they're designed to do. So when you're paying for one of those pumps, you're getting exactly what you're paying for, a pump that's going to work and keep your car cool. Quota water with real numbers, and it comes with all good stainless steel hardware, stainless steel apparel. Everything's clear-coated so it doesn't corrode and rust and stuff like that.
Oh, really? Yeah, and I'll tell you what, they're really sharp-looking, too.
Yeah, they are. I sold a bunch of them. They're great. Now, what have you done to the motors? Are the motors redesigned motors from the old motors?
Yeah, from the previous version water pumps, the motors are redesigned. We went and redesigned the motors and looked at the windings on the motors. We increased the amount of copper windings on the motors. We made everything as robust as possible and as efficient as possible. We were able to take some size out of it as far as the overall height of the electric motor as well and still maintain the efficiency that we previously had on the previous motors. And I'll tell you, you get a very, very good bang for your buck. There's an excellent, excellent torque value on these motors, and they just flat out work well.
Well, you know how you can tell they're efficient? Because the motor only draws 7 amps.
Mm-hmm.
So the motor's not working hard to turn it, so that shows you that it's a very efficient motor.
Yeah, they work very, very well. I can't say enough about them. The guys really went to task on the electric motor on these things.
Yeah, they're a great-looking piece. If anybody ever's got a chance, you got to check them out.
Mm-hmm.
I've been selling a lot of them. The guys have been loving them. And that bracket kit, I mean, that makes it so much simpler. You buy the pump, you can buy a bracket, you can mount your stuff. It's so clean and neat. The brackets come with all the correct hardware because they know what pump you're using and everything, so it's a no-brainer. And everything kind of interlocks into itself. It's just not sitting on top of it.
Yeah, the bracket kits, they're very, very nicely integrated kit. It's almost a seamless installation on those units. It's a really nice deal.
Yeah, you really did your homework on this stuff. Whoever designed this and did all the work really went through a lot, looked at a lot of little things and fixed a lot of little problems. I mean, just simple stuff like the spacers that hold the bracket to the pump. They actually push into the pump, so it takes a lot of strain and stress off of the bolts holding the alternator out there.
Oh yeah, we got a very, very good team of engineers that have worked on the projects, and we got some really good guys working on our team.
Yeah, it's adjustable with a rod end, and I mean, it's so simple.
We like you said earlier, Steve. We like to keep it simple.
Yeah, it's very clean. It's very clean. And another thing I wanted to your arbors. You make the arbors. You have all the arbors available to drive everything. So it's not like they have to hunt around to find anything. Everything is available.
Oh yeah, no, everything's available. The drive manuals that we have. I mean, we have our old standbys, and we have some updated units that are flange mounted bolts to the front of the balancers to help drive these kits. And we've got a full complement of selection of types of pulleys, going from your typical V-belt style pulleys to a square tooth Gilmer style drives, or your latest radius tooth stuff.
Exactly.
So we pretty much get everything.
Another small thing that people don't know you make, and I have a lot of people when I show it to them, and they're amazed that it even exists: crankshaft shim kit for the pulley and a water pump pulley shim kit.
Oh yeah.
Mm-hmm. For guys who are just running
pretty
themselves. Yeah.
Yeah. Those are pretty important. I mean, talk about trying to make your finite adjustments on your pulley alignments. They help out tremendously.
Yeah, it's a quick fix for a big problem that people have been chasing for years, and it's all available to straighten out your belt. So if you do have to run a V-belt or you're running a serpentine belt and you're running a water pump, it'll help you line everything up so you don't wear the belt or throw it.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, any misalignment, especially on your V-belt type systems, I mean, high RPM, you'll definitely pitch the belts off.
Yeah, yeah.
I think we've all been there somewhere along the lines.
Oh yeah, we've all chased that ghost many times.
Mm-hmm.
Many times.
Yep.
And absolutely. Then you got a whole bunch of catch cans too. You come out with some new catch cans for the new cars and everything in the cooling. The covers and stuff.
Absolutely. With respect to being able to increase the bling factor under the hoods and be as functional as possible, we've really looked at and have come out with a lot of really, really nice underhood components that will aid in the in your cooling system as well, especially in your modern vehicle. A lot of the new modern cooling systems are very utilitarian in look. They kind of look like blisters under the hood when you pop the hood. It don't look very sharp, and Ricky Moroso just likes the stuff to look really, really, really nice and be clean. And we came out with a lot of really nice coolant tanks and under hood trim applications for your latest your late model Mustangs, Camaros and Dodge Challengers and Chargers and all those pretty much all the latest platforms. We even have stuff for Mazda Miata road race cars and your latest Corvettes.
So we not only have the old traditional plastic overflow tank,
mm-hmm.
we also have that universal dinosaur coolant tank,
yeah.
universal brown one.
Mm-hmm.
I call it a dinosaur because I've been selling that since I started selling parts.
hey, well, we're taking a trip down memory lane here, Steve, that's for sure.
And then you got to check out these coolant tanks. I mean, you got a universal coolant tank. The 63766 is gorgeous.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have the 63769 with the tube on the side, so you can actually see how much fluid is in the tank.
Yep.
And I mean, these things are like jewelry for a car. They're gorgeous. And then you have the custom fit cooling tanks, like you were touching on it. Fit anything from Mustangs to Corvettes to Mazda Miatas to whatever you got.
Oh yeah, I mean Subarus. I mean,
Chrysler, the Dodge Chrysler Charger Magnums. That's a real pretty looking tank. Get rid of my wife.
Oh, yeah.
Plastic one.
Mm-hmm.
And you got
built
caps
the
and stuff.
The coolant system accessories, the underhood stuff for the late model vehicles, they're just absolutely beautiful. And and they really can transform the look, the underhood look, tremendously. I mean, I can't speak more highly about them.
Then you got all kinds of dress-up covers and power steering tanks. That's going to be another show because that's a lot of stuff there.
Oh yeah, we can touch on all that stuff. I mean,
that's some gorgeous stuff.
The supercharger coolant tanks, the power steering tanks, the covers. The brake booster covers and these panel covers.
That is all
gorgeous stuff. It just goes on and on, and it's all real high quality, real high looking, great looking stuff, and it's all made here in the United States, right in the factory in Connecticut, by U.S. craft.
Yeah. And we got to get into your training pans, your training pan gaskets, your dipsticks coming with the locking, and we'll get into all that on the next show. That's going to be a big show just talking about some of that stuff, the new stuff.
I think a lot of people don't realize how much stuff that we actually produce and the amount of applications that we actually make product for. It's tremendous.
Oh, it's amazing. And the nice thing is, if anybody's ever looked at a Moroso catalog, there's a section of new products, and they show all the new products that they come out with.
Mm-hmm.
And in the back of the book, you actually got a section for like Mustangs and Camaros, where you got the products that are for those cars specifically, Chargers. So, if they got a new Mustang or a new Camaro or a new Charger, all the products they can look up just for that car at the end of the Moroso catalog before the competition engineering.
Yeah, the nice part about the catalog, and I really feel our catalog is one of the best in the industry, is like you said, the new products are in the front of the catalog. The catalog's broken down, it's color coded, so you can flip through and figure out what section you're in really quickly. There is, like you said, to reiterate, there is a section on the back of the catalog which is vehicle-specific stuff for the late models. And if you know the part number and don't know where to look, at the end of the catalog is actually a numerical index where you can look up the part number and it will tell you what page everything's on.
There you go. See?
Yeah.
And
not,
we were talking on a show last
index.
Week. Yeah. We were talking about
content.
A show last week about the Moroso catalog. Back in the day when I want to say it was like 25 or 30 pages, every
mm-hmm.
part number was in there numerically in the catalog, and all the stuff was indexed together. So if you were looking for a cooling product and you knew the prefix, you could just go to that prefix and there was all the cooling products.
It very much is still like that today, Steve. Very much so.
Yeah?
Yep.
Yeah, it is. It is. It's a very simple catalog to use. Like you said, it's one of the best in the industry. Gives a lot of information. I mean, if you just got the catalog, it breaks down wet sump stuff. And in the back, there's a lot of, under competition engineering, suspension.
Oh, yeah.
There's a whole lot of information there in the back about chassis and leaf springs and, you know, why what does what and how to fix it.
Oh, absolutely. There's a tremendous amount of information in this catalog. It's you know, it's definitely not a few-minute read.
No. No, it's something you want to keep around and just buzz through, and you'd be surprised at the stuff these guys make. It's amazing.
Oh, yes, absolutely. There's a tremendous amount of stuff, and there's a lot of resources. And there's a lot of resources in the catalog. And there's also a lot of good people like yourself that know a lot about the product. And we've got a pretty good tech line, too. Very, very knowledgeable.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, we use it all the time. You know that.
Yeah, absolutely. Hey, we love
well,
it,
Kevin,
that's for sure.
Kevin, we got you coming on again, I think, in 3 weeks. We are going to hammer out some of the, probably we'll go into the vacuum pumps, the oil pans, the transmission pans, stuff like that, because you got a lot of cool shit on that we really need to touch base on.
Oh, absolutely. We can knock it out of the park with pretty much anything you want to talk about. You know, whether it be oil pans, vacuum pumps, dry sump pumps, transmission pans. We can handle it.
Yeah, we got a lot of stuff to talk about. But if anybody's got a chance, you want to check out the latest and baddest electric water pumps. www.moroso.com. And don't forget, look at the brackets they got available for the alternators and vacuum pumps. They got the drives, you can buy the pulleys, the belts, they got everything. One source, one order, you can get the whole thing, go home, slap it on, and race the car.
That's pretty much right.
No need to look anywhere else, you got it all in one catalog. Let me see if I put Carl. Carl, did I put you to sleep?
No, I'm listening. You know, I kind of wanted to ask Kevin one or two things, if you don't mind.
Go ahead.
Sure.
It's all yours.
I keep hearing all this talk about reverse flow cooling systems and things of that nature, and I was just wondering from the from your research and things that you guys have done at Moroso, what's the reason why you would do reverse flow and how do you accomplish that?
Well, most of the pumps that we use, Carl, aren't. You know, in systems that we build for aren't reverse flow cooling type applications. But the major purpose for utilizing a reverse flow coolant system is to be more efficient in the cooling process. Trying to cool around the tops of the cylinders and the rear of the cylinder heads first, realistically. But yeah, that's the basic system in general on a reverse flow deal. Still with me, Carl?
Yeah, I'm here. I lost you there for a minute.
Mm-hmm. You need me to repeat anything at all, or?
Can you hear me now?
There you go.
Hear you perfectly.
Holy crow! What a pain in the butt. We're having a bad equipment week.
Yeah.
Well, you're up there in Ohio. Do they still have outdoor toilets up there in Ohio?
We got outdoor, indoor, upside, left side, reverse flow. We got it all.
You got it all, huh?
You know, out there in the sticks out there, I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know
yeah,
what I'm saying, Kev? Us city boys got it made.
We got streets and stuff. We do have some Amish people. You got to be careful not to throw.
Hopefully you got some street lights.
Yeah, that guy goes around and lights them up every night.
Yeah.
Anyway,
there you go.
So I lost you, but I hope that the question brought to light some of the questions that I had relative to or answers to the whole process of that reverse flow deal.
Yeah. I mean, hopefully I was able to answer a little bit of the question before I lost you. But what I was saying to reiterate is that a lot of the coolant systems that we imply at Moroso are kind of a standard flow coolant system, as opposed to the most recent late model reverse flow cooling system. And the differences are really the efficiency in which the reverse flow cooling systems can cool the very tops of the cylinder walls and the cylinder heads to help eliminate any hot spots in them as well. But that's the efficiency levels of the latest cooling systems in general.
Are you guys taking a separate approach to an engine that may be filled with a block filler product, or is that something that you take into consideration when you're recommending a specific system?
Well, that's something that's completely independent in general. There are a lot of systems that are a lot of engines that, especially drag race engines, and some to a lesser extent, endurance engines are filled with a block filler, whether it be a block cement or what have you, and. The considerations you got to take when doing something along those lines is to make sure that you get adequate cooling flow around the tops of the cylinders, particularly. That's where the majority of the heat rejection happens, within the first, realistically, in the neighborhood of the first 45 to 72 degrees of the piston travel. So you got to take advantage of all the cooling that you can by running some external lines in between any Siamese cylinders or what have you. And generally, we like to run those from the, you know, anything in the block, any cooling lines from the block. We like to run them between the, say like 3 and 5 and 4 and 6 cylinders on like a Chevrolet, so to speak, and run those coolant lines back to the inlet of the pump to help circulation and coolant flow.
Well, I know there's a lot to be learned, and I also know that, you know, the majority of the folks are on our show listening in are probably drag racers, but you guys have also had quite a history in the oval track, genres as well, and so there's a lot to be learned, you know, from, like you say, the endurance-style engines. And, I just for one want to say that I've always thought, and, you know, if you guys remember back in the day, Steve, I had a Camaro, right? And
mm-hmm.
underneath my Camaro, there used to have a picture of a black Camaro that was invisible, and it had frame connectors, it had front subframe bushings, it had ladder bars, it had a floater system, and I don't know what else. Well, my car was that exact car. And so I've been a proponent of Moroso, and I've sold plenty of Moroso in my day as well. And I just think the world of that product line, always have. And the catalog is kind of like goes like this. It's like a best read. You can actually learn, you know, a lot more from the Moroso catalog about the way to get things handled properly with all of your accessorization of your car. I mean, from one end to the other, literally, there's a Moroso product that's probably adequate, whether it be part of your charging system, your battery, your from front to back, literally. So my hat's off to your company, all the guys up there. I know Scott, and, of course, Rick's a friend, as has been for years, and, of course, Howard, who does the road show, been out there forever.
Everybody knows Howard.
Yeah, I mean, Howard is like, he's like a standard bearer. If Howard ain't there, there ain't no reason to be there.
that guy feels that way, that's for sure.
Well, I mean, that guy's not replaceable. I mean, he's just been there forever, and we love him to death. So you guys do a great job, and we can't wait till we get you back in a couple, 3 weeks to do a little bit more in-depth look at some of the other products.
I look forward to it.
We got so much stuff to go over that it's going to take a couple episodes to get it all in. Hey, Kev, before we let you go, I want to ask you about one thing. I've been trying to get the big kahuna on here, the main cheese, the man with the plan, the guy who knows everything, but I haven't done it yet. So give us a little breakdown about this grumpy poster. What do you know about it?
Well, the basically the reprinting of the Grumpy's toy poster is kind of a tribute to homage to Bill Grumpy Jenkins himself. And, majority of the proceeds are going to his Draw Foundation, if not all the proceeds. I'd have to look at the information, associated with it. But, it's kind of a tribute to Bill Grumpy Jenkins himself and his wife. He's been instrumental in a lot of the products that Mark has developed over the years. And,
speaking of developed products, I know that all this stuff we've been talking about, Rick has probably tested on his own vehicle before it even went in the catalog, huh?
Oh man, yeah. Rick's pretty insatiable about making sure that product's pretty well tested, and if we have a vehicle platform to develop anything off of, it gets that's the platform it gets developed off of. So, realistically, any of the latest Mustang components that have been developed were developed right in house off of Rick Moroso's vehicle. The Challenger stuff was developed right in house. Absolutely. Majority of all the products have been on one of Ricky's race cars somewhere along the lines. That I can promise you.
Yeah, I know. We've watched him race for years down here. We miss him down here. I wish he'd come back down someday.
Okay. Well, you keep on asking. He just might, that's for sure.
Yeah, it's always fun to see him out there. Great guy. You got a good boss there.
Yeah, well,
runs a good company.
Got one of the best. I'm pretty happy to be associated with the guys.
Yeah, he's a great guy. All right, Kev, well, we're going to thank you for coming on, and we will see you in about 3 weeks, and we'll be discussing some more stuff. I'd like to get into the tranny pans. You got some killer tranny pans.
Mm-hmm.
You got a whole bunch of new oil pans and the tranny pan gaskets out of the blue. What do you call that blue material?
That's a hard durometer silicone.
There you go. Hard durometer silicone. That's great stuff. Mm-hmm. All right. We're gonna move into our grudge talk section here. I got Gary French and Big Low online, and we're getting Mr. Burns on. So, Kev, I want to thank you for coming on, and I'm sure I'll talk to you during the week.
All right, thank you, Steve. I appreciate it. Thanks, guys.
All right, thanks.
Yeah.
There you go. That's Kevin Brown. Also, great guy. Anything you want to talk about, anything. Really great guy. Let's see if we can get Gary and Big Low on here. We got them waiting for us. Let's get Gary on here. Hey, Gary, you're with
50,
us. You're on the air with...
Okay. I got 50 that says they're on there.
Okay. Hey, Gary, you're on with Carl and Steve. How are you?
Great. How about yourself, man?
Good. We got Big Low on. We're going to get on, too. We're going to talk about both of your races. Why don't you tell us... Let's get Big Low on here. Hey, Big Low, you with us? Big Low, you there?
Yeah, I'm here, Steve. What's going on?
Hey, how you doing? You're on with Carl, Mike, and we got Gary on. We're going to have Gary talk a little bit about his race he's got going up there in Kentucky. So hang in there with us. We're trying to get Mr. Barnes. Oh, Mr. Barnes is on here, too. Let's get him on here. We'll have a whole mess of people going on. Mr. Barnes, you're on with us. Are you there, Mr. Barnes?
I am.
I guess he's there.
How you doing this evening?
Good. You're on. We got Gary on, Gary French, Big Low, Carl's on here, and I'm Steve. We're going to have Gary talk a little bit about what he's got going on up there.
All right, all right.
Go ahead, Gary. Tell us what you got going, Gary.
All right, on August the 18th, we're holding a grudge race up at US 60 Dragway in Hardinsburg, Kentucky. Gates are going to open at 9 o'clock. We're going to run probably till 1, 2, 3, however long anybody wants to run. In the middle of it, we're going to have a leaf spring shootout. It's going to pay $2,000 to win with a free entry fee. Hoping to see a lot of guys from a bunch of other states and stuff come on down up and down to Kentucky because we're right in the middle, you know. Looking to be a good time. Got a lot of feedback. A lot of guys are acting like they're wanting to come to it. Been working with Jay on the race, so it's looking pretty good. The rules on the leaf spring race are pretty much 29.5, 10.5, or a 315 drag radial. Leaf springs, as long as it's not a tube chassis style car, and no floaters with ladder bars or four links. Heads up, pro tree, no time shown. Draw the hat. First man to the finish line wins.
There you go. Is this the first time you've done a leaf spring race up in there, or is this the first one for you? Have you done them before?
Yeah, yes, sir. It's the first time we've had one. I was looking where they're, you know, there's always somewhere to race a G-body or a Mustang, but there's no place to race a leaf spring. So, you know, S10s,
yeah, well,
Novas, all that will fit in.
I think it's a growing class. I think it's a lot of fun. I think there's, like you said, there's a lot of guys with leaf springs that got nowhere to race, so I'm sure they'll be happy to hear it.
Right.
You know, give us a little idea. Where is this track in Kentucky?
It's located in Hardinsburg, Kentucky. It's about an hour from Louisville, Kentucky, about an hour and 15 minutes from Bowling Green, Kentucky. It's probably about 45 minutes off of I-65, which is a major interstate. Easy to get to, little eighth-mile track. Been there since 1964. It's a good little place to race. Yeah.
Yeah, and you guys have a lot of fun out there. The track lets you just go out and have fun. The guys can grudge race. They can barbecue. They can talk. They can BS. They can do whatever they want, right?
Right. We can do whatever we want. If somebody wants 10 cars and a break, you can get it. So
there you
go.
Know,
we can
so the
do
guys
whatever
can come
we
out
want
and
to
have
do.
Fun. They can come out and have fun.
It's for bikes or cars. We're going to grudge race bikes or cars, either one. So
anything you
want to
bring out the race, kid. Yeah, as long as you got a pair, you can pair them up on the lane, you'll race them, right?
Right.
There you go. Cool. All right, let's ask Big Lo. Lo, are you with us? Tell us a little bit about what you got going on at County Line. Gary, I want you to hang in there because I want to talk about this grudge ink, too. Go ahead, Big.
Okay.
Tell us what you got going on. Big Lo, you there? I think you went to get a sandwich. Big Lo, you didn't go get a sandwich, did you?
Nah, I go get it. I was on mute. I thought I was on.
There you go. Tell us a little bit about what you got going on down at County Line.
We have a little race down here in County Line on August 25th, grudge ink race. Pine Trees versus Palm Trees. You know how it is. South versus
right,
North.
Right.
Got a Tony Bonds and the boys coming down. We're going to have a little G-body shootout. Back half shootout and the 28 and 29 tie race together. We're gonna have some fun down here.
Yeah, the last one you had was packed and everybody had a blast. Everybody I talked to said they had a great time down there.
Yeah, man. You know, everybody have fun. Ain't no argument. Just had, you know how to race, man. Just want, you know, just go down two cars down the track. You know how it is. You know how it is, Steve. You know how it is out here.
Yeah, County Line's a great track. You can go out there. That's one of my favorite tracks to have fun. When we go down there and race, we take about five or six people. We set up a big tent. We set up our grill. We set up our radio, our fan. We put together. We have a party, and then we break out into a race. It's a lot of fun down there. You can do anything you want.
Yeah, gate's going to be open up at 12, and lane's going to be ready for 2 o'clock. So we're going to be going on from 2 to 12. And, you know, everybody come on out, $20 admission. We're going to have some fun down here. Some good grudge racing.
Yeah, you get there early because it's going to fill up fast, too.
Yes, it is.
Yeah, so you actually got somebody to race you? How'd you swindle somebody into racing you? Did they not know who you are or what?
No, well, actually, they done whooped my butt a couple times already, Steve. But, you know, you're going to give me a chance down in my hometown, so maybe the tables will turn, you know, where it's full of grudge ain't built. So, you know, see what's going on.
Yeah, because you've been with your program a long time. Your program's pretty stout. It's put together, and it works good.
Yeah, but he just got my number.
Yeah?
I just met one person out of there. He just met one person. He got my number, Steve. That's all.
Yeah, yeah. Well, that's cool. So we got these two grudge races coming on, one in Kentucky, one in South Florida. It's good to see these guys putting something on and actually have a place for these guys to go race and not have them racing on the street and stuff, you know, bring them to a track where it's safe, take some of the bad image away from the grudge racing, and let somebody's track see how it can work, how it can draw spectators, and maybe we'll see more of it at different tracks, you know? What we can hope for.
True.
Well, we got Mr. Barnes on here. Mr. Barnes, you on with us?
Yes. I'm here. Just call me Jay, please. And
okay.
Listen, you know, you got Gary and Big Low on the line. Now you got to remember, they are they're not much talkers, but you know, I take up where they fall short on the talking side. So they trying to give you good, the pertinent information, but I can talk to you now. If you don't mind,
okay.
Go back to Gary. You know, let me tell you, if you have not seen Gary's car, Gary got one of the unique cars you ever see, Leaf Spring. And I don't want to say much about it because it's kind of a surprise and something that he want to bring out, you know, on his show date. So I want, he has a phenomenal Leaf Spring car. He's looking for action. And he don't necessarily have to run a Leaf Spring car. He's a good racer. And for the people that don't know, he's a good racer from way back. And, you know, the whole, we've had commitment to come to his show as far as Chicago and Detroit coming down. So a couple of guys out of New Jersey is coming down. So, you know, Gary's going to have an excellent show. Again, it's in the middle of the country. It was selected that way by design. I believe in the future, that's going to be one of the bigger races that we'll have because of where it's located geographically, where everybody can kind of come together in a neutral location. But, you know, he's going to have an excellent show. He's got strong support. So, you know, again, Gary's also, and I know when you call me, you said, well, I got Gary on. I was like saying, you know, okay, who is Gary? Because to me, that's G-Shot. And that's what I call. So, he's also in the grudge ink world, he's the governor of Kentucky. In other words, he controls Kentucky for us, and he's gonna have an excellent show. And moving down to Big Low, Big Low was saying that the guy that he's got the race got his number, but I want everybody to know that Big Low was the G-Body champion for the last three consecutive years prior to his loss, and he just been trying to get his program back. So it's not, you know, he has a strong program, and, he's making some adjustments, and he lost the title. He lost the champion title, but his day is coming. He's been consistently making progress to get the championship back. So don't let Big Low talk you out of, like, as if to say he's not a major player in the game. I agree. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
We all know Big Low in South Florida down here. And
yeah,
he's definitely
yeah.
a player to reckon with.
Again, he's got also, you know, coming down the county line. I was down a little earlier this year, and in the Grudge Inc. magazine, we highlighted a lot of the track activities in this month's issue. A lot of the racers and spectators are in the magazine. So, you know, South Florida is an excellent place, not only to race, but to come and spend money, relax, and enjoy yourself, you know. And I believe, like I said again, he will be having an excellent race also. So I just want to show support for them and, good luck in this venture this weekend, that weekend.
Yeah, well, I wasn't familiar with G-Shot, but now that we know he's G-Shot, I'm sure both these guys are going to do great. Like you said, he's centrally located. Big Low's got a little bit of an issue because he's at the end of the world, but he can draw a lot of people. That
yeah.
track will fill up.
speak.
And tell us a little bit about this organization you started. It's called Grudge Inc. Tell us a little bit about it.
Well, Grudge Inc. is just basically going back to what you were saying earlier. It's painting a better face for grudge racers. People have a negative image of grudge racers, generally saying that they have ugly cars, they street race, they do, you know, basically illegal side. But, you know, that is so far from the truth. The grudge race cars of today, you know, cars that range, I'm just going to say, like the current champion for Grudge Inc. small block style suspension, you know, is probably a $60,000 car. You know, it's nothing about it cheap. It's nothing about it inexpensive. It has the best of everything. It has the best safety equipment, engine, transmission, and will definitely whoop any car in the country in its class. You know, that is the image of grudge racing that Grudge Inc. promotes. Safety first.
Right.
Safety first. Fun. And then grudge racing. You know, grudge racing, again, we're kind of spreading across the country. We're trying to uplift grudge racing, which we don't want people racing on the streets, and we mainly don't want them racing on the streets and calling themselves grudge racers. No, those are illegal street racers. That's not us. our people are safety conscious first. You know, none of the guys that support Grudge Inc. support street racing. That's not us, you know. Now, there is such thing as an ugly duckling in grudge racing, but it's only part of the illusion. But if you look a little bit past the skin, you'll see that is a top-notch drag racing car, you know, with all the modern technologies, you know, and safety equipment on it. So, but again, Grudge Inc. is meant to uplift all grudge racing across the country. We're trying to highlight people who don't show their time. You know, I mean, there's a lot of magazines, there are a lot of different things that are people who give their whole recipe, who built their engine, how fast they ran, on what day. Grudge racers don't do that. So we're trying to uplift and bring name recognition to the people who don't show their time, you know, and whose engine is just as expensive, if not even more so, and who compete, you know, across the country on a daily basis. Now, this is one thing I'll tell you. Grudge racing itself is, I tell everybody, it occurs every weekend across the country. That's the only, you know, that's the only type of racing that occurs pretty much at every track every weekend. And so we're just trying to put a little organization to it. We're trying to put a little faith. So let's identify some of the key people in it and make it rise to the top. So I don't want to... go ahead. I'm sorry.
I think you're on the right track because I can attest to what you're saying. I got some of my customers. I'm in Pompano Beach. Some of my customers are like the Strawbridge Brothers. I'm sure you know them and guys like that. And some of those cars are top-notch cars, could go out and compete in NHRA classes and win. So there's not a lot of low-dollar cars. There's a lot of high-dollar cars, big Lowe's car. You know, all these cars are not cheap cars, and they're competitive cars. And, you know, so I think what you're doing is putting a good face on grudge racing and changing the image, because nothing upsets me more. We have a news station down here called Channel 7 News. And whenever there was a car accident, and it was any kind of sports car, it was always drag racer or grudge racer accident, you know. And like you said, it was illegal street racers or just some kids speeding along, and they call it, put a bad face on drag racing and grudge racing from it. So what you're doing needed to be done, and I'm glad you're doing it. If Trax wanted to get a hold of you to do something, how do they get a hold of Grudge Inc.?
Well, we have a pro board that's called grudgeinc.us, and we generally post. You can send me a private message in there, you know, Jay Barnes or... In every, you know, on all the key grudge racing states at the moment, like Big Lowe's Camp is a representative of Grudge Inc. Gary is a representative of Grudge Inc. We have representatives throughout the country that you can contact, but you can also contact me. My number is 478 501-407-4074 is the phone. I keep it with me all the time. You know, you can contact me directly or through any of the governors that's affiliated with Grudge Inc. And that's one of the things that we want to do. We're trying to bring organized, that's the key word, organized grudge racing to the local track. And we're going to support it and make sure that the tracks make money. You know, that's one of the things that I think, that's one of the caveats of Grudge Inc. right now is a lot of people are having bracket races and index races and not really making the bottom line work. With a grudge race, particularly one that's supported by Grudge Inc., you can bring two of the right people in and pack your fans compared to having to have 20 or 30 cars in a bracket or index race and still not kind of come out well. Grudge racing, it is built on the old-time rivalry system. Any good rivalry, you know, is always going to draw more spectators than your average show. Grudge racing is that. It highlights the rivalries that different people from different states, different areas, you know, even different car types have. And when it's done in an organized manner, the people that's affiliated with it make money. And that's what we're doing. We're having fun and making money.
Well, if you talk to any of my customers, they'll tell you I'm the biggest shit talker out here about grudge racing. I love to get everybody's goat. And I think it adds a lot of fun to the sport. I think it's great. I like the system you got, too, because you got governors, you were calling them, or actually representatives for certain areas to control, you know, that area and try and get more tracks involved. I think that's going to be a positive move by having somebody actually in the area work with the tracks.
Yeah, we definitely have. You know, and now we're heavy on the East Coast. You know, we got Florida, Georgia, Tennessee, Kentucky, Illinois. I'm just off the top of my head, Michigan, North Carolina, Virginia, Maryland. These are where we have governors at now, and they are working to that's why Big Low is that county line, because he's trying to – eventually we're going to have a program there. You know, we're trying to help the track, and we're trying to bring the grudge racers into the area. That's why Gary is in Kentucky. He's with this event. He will eventually – you know, it's designed to put the seed there where it can become more organized, where the track owners – now can have a program that produce money for us, and that's what we're trying to back, you know.
Yeah, I like the idea. I want you to send me, whenever you have flyers for any of your races anywhere, if you would send them to info@shraonline.com, we will post them on our website, and I'll read them on a radio show every Tuesday where the races are held.
Okay.
If you
well, we'll definitely
you
do that now. We have a lot of them now. Like, for an example, I'm going to give you, you know, on the 18th, we have one in Detroit, Michigan, one in Kentucky with Gary. We got one with Big Low. And then coming up on the 1st of the month, we got on the 1st of September, we got the Mississippi Gangster out in Mississippi. We have Mike Hill in Macon. We got Good Ink in Macon again. You know, we keep shows going that we're supporting, again, just trying to make sure that we, highlight grudge racing.
Hey, exactly, Steve, exactly. Yeah.
We need to tell the folks that they have a Facebook. They can go on to Grudge Inc. on the Facebook, and plus they can go to jbarnes.proboards.com, and actually there's a schedule out there, and I'm just amazed at how organized this already is. And, you know, it's just going to keep growing because everybody's got the passion for it. They want to be racing. They want to make it fun and exciting. So I think Jay, you know, Jay may have some governors, but I think we found us a new president.
Yay. Well, we have a mayor now. We got a president.
Yeah.
The way I'm seeing it, brother.
Well, listen,
yeah, he's doing a good job.
This is one thing that we do. This is definitely what we do also. I like to tell, if you're a promoter out of your track, if you have a grudge race event coming up, or you want, if you would send it to us to grudgeinc.us, going off pro boards, or jbarnes.proboards.us, either one. If you would send us your information, we'll make sure that, you know, that at this point we have about 8,000 participating members across the country, so we'll send it out to them. We do email blasts once or twice a week. We don't want to overload them with it, but we try to promote anyone that's doing grudge racing in a safe, you know, and productive manner.
Well, there you go. I'm very glad you stepped up and took charge of this and you got this thing worked out, because you really needed it with grudge racing. Like I said, some of the most fun I had was going up to, you know, Palm Beach when they had their grudge event, going down to some of the other local tracks when they had their grudge event. I had a lot of fun at that.
Yeah. Oh, you have a ball. We just came out of, we did it in Morocco, Indiana, but it was actually the Illinois race that we did, and we had a phenomenal, great time. We have, you know, they treated us to the South went up. We had the best food. We was treated very well. We raced. I just want everybody to know that the South whooped the North something serious.
There you go. That's what I'm talking about.
The South put something on the North, and North is looking for a little revenge. Also, you know, early this year, we was in Montgomery, Alabama, at the track Montgomery Motorsport. We've had two events over there that was excellent. So I like to mention those guys. And let me tell you this, we're getting a lot of tracks that's coming online and that's working with Grudge Inc. And particularly, I like to say, County Line, that's where, you know, the 18th, but also Lakeland Dragway in Florida. We will be visiting there soon. We've had a conversation with them. Montgomery Motorsport, Macon National Dragway, South Georgia Motorsport, also Virginia Motorsport. You know, I can't think of all the names, but the tracks themselves have reached, and this is what I really appreciate, the tracks themselves are reaching out so that we can come and support them, you know, so it's not such a hard sell for us, because we don't know who, everybody don't like grudge racing because they have the wrong image. But as they start to see in the correct image and to see what kind of show and what kind of people that we got coming with us. Now, I'm just giving an example. We got, through Grudge Inc., we got pro mods that, you know, that can run 3 seconds. All a part of, you know, the grudge movement. So you can really see a good show, you know. And so I welcome the tracks to give us a call, and as well as promoters. Do it, you know, whatever we can do to try to make track racing better, you know.
Well, I'm going to give you a call during the week because I got some things I want to work on. But you mentioned something I got to touch on. You mentioned Lakeland Drag Strip. And Ozzy is a good supporter of the SHRA. He's been on the radio show. And I wanted to thank his wife, Maria, David Hill, and Eddie Lopez, because Mike and I were over at the track, and it was like 10:30, 11 o'clock at night. The food court was closed down and cleaned up, and we were getting ready to leave, and I asked her if she had any food, and she went ahead and fired up the grill and cooked us some hamburgers. That's the
great
kind of people they are there. They're good people. You can't go wrong with Ozzy.
Right,
great guy.
Right. Well, I look forward to we've only had phone conversations. I'll probably meet him next week. And we'll definitely be a Grudge Inc. program there. So all your local grudge people in the Lakeland area, get prepared, you know.
There you go. We need it. We need to see it. We need to get something going. All right, G-Shot, you still with us? Give us your date and times one more time and your phone numbers.
All right. August 18th, the gates are actually going to open at 9. We're hoping to be running by noon. The Leaf Spring Shootout will probably happen around 7 o'clock Central Time, somewhere in there, after the sun starts going down a little bit. It's at US 60 Dragway in Hardinsburg, Kentucky. And anybody wants any information, they can get a hold of me at 270-945-5232, or they can look on grudgeinc.us for any information under the great state of Kentucky thread. It'll tell you everything you need to know.
There you go. And we got Lo. You still with us, Lo, or did you fall asleep and get another sandwich? He puts us on mute and he goes and eats a sandwich, I think. He's going to smack me when he sees me because I know he's going to see me down at that grudge race. I got to tell you, Big Lo ran my first race I ever put on at Palm Beach, and he won the stock suspension class.
Yeah, Big Lo is a heavy contender. He's very, very competitive, one of the friendliest guys you ever meet, you know, and he's out to win.
Yeah, he's a good guy, Big Lo. We love him. Big Lo, you with us yet? Okay, Jay, tell us about Big Lo's race. What? Give us some info on it, if you would. You know the times or the dates?
No, I do know that it's the 25th of this month, and it's a kind of line dragway. I don't really know the time, so I'm gonna get there early. I do know that my granddaughter's coming in. I do know that if you don't get there, by 11, you're gonna be parked outside. So I don't know exactly what time. It will be full. So the 25th County Line Dragway, you know, Big Lo and Good Team will be, partying hard.
Well, when you see the black 65 Chevelle there, just come over and get me. We'll take it. We'll go get some burgers, and we'll come back, and I'll race some people.
It sounds like a winner.
There you go. All right, Jay, I want to thank you. I'm going to be calling you during the week because I got something I got to talk to you about. G-Shot, we thank you for coming on, and I hope you have a really good show out there. I hope the weather's really good for you. I hope you get a good turnout of spectators and racers. And maybe after the race, you can come on and give us a little hype about what happened.
I appreciate your time, man.
All right, cool. Looking forward to hear what went on at the race and who raced who and who won what. And we'll get in touch with you after your race, if that's okay.
That's cool. You can get a hold of me. I'll give you a lowdown on what happened.
There you go. Big Lo, you back with us yet?
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay, we're going to be down there. Hopefully you didn't hear what I was saying about you while you weren't on the radio.
No, I didn't even talk about Steve.
I'm going to be down near the county line racing. So we're looking forward to see you down there. And after the race, like I said, we'll have you back on. Maybe we can get some sheets and some rundowns and see who ran who and who you beat up on. And, if you do good, maybe you can buy dinner that night.
No problem. My treat, man. No problem. No problem with that.
See, I worked that one in there, Jay. I was pretty slick, wasn't I?
Yeah, you down there pretty good. That, but let me tell you, did you see the Drag Illustrated picture of G-Shot's car with the cardboard parachute?
No.
I want you to look at matter of fact, this month's issue of Drag Illustrated, Big Lo is in there. G-Shot brought the Lake National Dragway with the paper parachute is in there, along with myself and some other good racers. We're all in there, so I want everybody to get a chance to look at that, too, if you are. But I really want everybody to pay attention to that parachute that G-Shot got.
G-Shot, you're going to hear about this one next week because I got the issue at home and I'll look at it.
All right. Just having some fun tonight.
I want to thank you all for coming on. Big Lo, G-Shot, Jay. Looking forward to being in touch with you guys and helping you promote this any way we can. Like I said, my guy Michael, get a hold of you and maybe we can link you with the SHRA radio show and we'll link your website on ours and help each other get the word out.
All right, I really appreciate it.
All right, thanks guys.
Thank you.
Hey, Carl, what do you think? They all run Mickey Thompson tires?
Well, I hope they do for sure, but I will tell you that there's a real movement, and these guys are going to get it done. And I can tell you also that, you can go online to us60dragracing.com and find out a little bit about the racetrack in Hardinsburg. It is an 8-mile facility. It's got some photos of the place, and it's been around, as G-Shot said there, it's been around since 1964, so it's pretty legendary, and sure is going to have a great event over there. So, you know, it's I'm excited because, you know what, this is a whole other group of customers that are actually coming to the surface now. You got G-Shot, you got all these other fellas that are coming out, Turbo Tim and Alabama, and it's just going on, and it's kind of like there's a whole new language starting, so I'm kind of interested.
Yeah, it's real good. I'm glad to see Jay take the reins of this thing and get it organized and get some positive input and positive image of it going, because I think once the track owners and the tracks change their image of grudge racing to being something wrong to seeing it as being something profitable and fun and filling the tracks up and the tracks making money and the racers having a place to race, like Jay said, safe environment, a legal environment. I mean, it's a win-win situation all the way around.
Well, it is, and it's not what it used to be. I mean, years ago, yeah, we all raced on the road for money. We raced on the streets, and we got out there, and a lot of people got hurt. You know, people that didn't even have any involvement got hurt. But these guys are organized. They want to do it on a safe facility. They don't want to do it behind, you know, closed doors, so to speak, and it's out there for everybody to see. And like I said, it's a whole new language. You got the Alabama Nuggets. You got Turbo Tim. You got G-Shot. I mean, come on. This is fun. This is awesome. And I got to put my hat off to Jay. I mean, he's put it together and getting everybody, like, he's got a whole posse, you know, and it goes from almost coast to coast, and it's going to just keep growing. So I'm all in. I can't hardly wait to see one of these races.
Yeah, I think it's a good movement. And like you said, you know, I've been around it forever, so the names aren't as surprising to me as they are to you. But, yeah, that definitely adds some intrigue to it to see, you know, instead of Joe Racer or Sam Shifter, to see some really cool names and, cool, you know, the cars are really, really flamboyant. It's a lot of fun.
Yeah, you're talking about Big Low and the Icy Boys, and I mean, you can go out on the internet and just check it out. They got some good YouTube stuff cooking. I've been watching it while y'all are talking, and you know, it's all good. It's been happening for years and years, but now to bring it to a level of organization and a level of safety where it can be a fun thing, as I said, I think it's awesome. So,
we know Florida. We not only have a Big Low, but we have a Little Low too. And he runs the G-Body stuff all over the country. So, you know, we got all the lows covered. We need a medium low. Maybe I can be the medium low.
You could be like medium low to medium high. It just depends on what day it is.
Maybe I can be the good-looking Italian low. What do you think of that?
You could be the bald low.
Not a chance, huh? not a chance. I understand that one. How about Guido Low? I could be Guido Low.
Yeah.
Hey, I'm coming here. I'm going to race you for money. You put in your car in the beam. I put in my car in the beam. I beat you. You pay me. Or Joey Nonek, he come over. He talk to you. Forget about it.
That's funny. That's good stuff. You know, I'll be the senior low or whatever.
Somebody told me I could be solo.
Solo, you can't get out the fence.
Well, Carl, I think that's going to do it for us for another radio show. I want to thank Jay Burns for coming on, G-Shot, which is Gary French, and Big Low, which I won't give his name out. And I want to thank Kevin Brown from Moroso Performance Products for coming on. I want to thank Chris Matters for the 5 minutes of Matters. I got an update on... CJ Perez, Troy Perez's son, he's off of all the machines. Everything's doing well. His lungs are doing good. They're just waiting for him to be able to eat by himself, and they're sending him home. So hopefully in a couple days he'll be home with the Perez family and they'll be all together. So everything seems to be looking good on that standpoint.
That's a blessing.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. Nothing more important than anybody's health and family. Racing's all fun and games, but nothing's more important than that. And I want to thank you, and I want to thank Mike, the engineer, hiding behind the background and ain't said a word. Apparently, we got some bad news about CFRC. It's unconfirmed at this point, but it looks like the track is closed. because of the noise ordinance. So we'll have to find more. The drag strip has been closed by a county ruling. We have to actually confirm that, not authenticated at this time, but that's a shame. That was a beautiful track, good owners, nice people, really cared about racing, really wanted to do the right thing, and I hate to see a track close.
Yeah, that's just not the way we want to see things happen. And I want to throw in one more word for prayers for Mike Romeo. We had a moment of silence earlier. He's struggling, so let's put out a good word. And also, for those guys that hang out on the West Coast, we've seen it on the Yellow Bulletin. There's a guy that I've known for a long time. He's been a pro street racer. His name is Ed Thornton. He had his car and trailer stolen out of Chino, California, which is right around Pomona. It's kind of right between, it's between the 10 and the 91 right down there in Pomona and the Inland Empire. You know, guys, look for that stuff. See if you can't help Ed. I mean, this guy has worked all his life for this stuff, and to have it disappear is just a crying shame. And if we could ever catch the people that do this kind of crap, you know, there wouldn't be no question about a death penalty. We'll just take care of it.
Yeah, exactly. It's so frustrating. People put their life and soul into a car and somebody steals it. I mean, I got to tell everybody, my biggest fear of my car is fire getting it stolen, because I can fix anything on it, but I couldn't replace it. I just don't have the money anymore to replace it.
Well, you know, it's an accumulation of years and years of hard work and diligence and sacrifice. And, you know, Eddie has been part of that, you know, PSCA, you know, the West Coast Pro Mod scene forever. And he's legendary, and for him to lose his all of his stuff is just ridiculous. And just keep your eyes open out there. If anybody out in the California area and the Inland Empire is listening, I mean, who knows where this stuff ends up, but I know that the car is highly recognizable, okay? It's not like a car that you're going to see and say that's not Eddie's car. You're going to know it. So keep your eyes open.
There you go. And any of the tracks out there that want to get involved in this grudge racing or, check into this grudge racing, make sure you get a hold of Big Low in Florida or, you know, G-Shot out there in Kentucky, or just go to Jay Barnes and check out Grudge Inc. I mean, he's doing a good job there, and I'd like to see some tracks pick him up and support this because it's a good cause.
Yeah, he's got a good little forum-style website going, and it's not hard to get a hold of him. And, I think the more track owners, we got to talk to Jim at I-40. Maybe he can get in on this deal, too. I didn't hear his name called out, but, you know, he's going to have his show on, I guess, tomorrow night. So,
I wonder if Jay's on. Let me see if Jay's still here. Let me ask him something. Hey, Jay, you still with us?
Yes, I'm here.
That's the guy we can put you in contact with is Jim Howell. He's always open to a lot of stuff, and he's a very aggressive track owner. He has a radio show tomorrow. What's the name of his show tomorrow, Carl?
Honestly, I don't know. I don't know the name.
I just went blank. I announce it all the time.
Look it up.
Yeah, I-40 Dragway, Jay. He'd be a good guy. Jim Howell, he'd be a good guy for you to talk to, too.
Well, I love to talk to him. And, anything that you can do, you know how to contact me, or if you get me his information, I would love to, because, again, you know, we're trying to grow.
There you go.
And you,
well, anything we can do to help you, Jim, we're there for you, brother. You just ask.
People like Steve and me who work in this industry, we need more customers. Everybody's struggling along. We need more American manufacturing, and this is all about America. And it's all about the people that live here doing their thing. And so let's keep it going. That's all I'm saying.
All right, Jay. I'll be in touch with you during the week, Jay. Thanks a lot, buddy.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, I'll send him that information on Howell. That's a good guy to talk about. Bounty Talk Radio, that's the name of it, Carl. Bounty Talk Radio. It's on tomorrow night, I think, at 9 o'clock.
Yeah, I apologize to Jim for not knowing, but I'm a senior citizen almost, so I gotta be blaming old age on that one.
Yeah, me too. I just lost it. And my guy Mike, the engineer, tells me that the links are already up on the SHRA website for Grudge Inc. So if anybody wants any information, you go to our website, shraonline.com, and there'll be a logo for Grudge Inc. And you can punch it, and it'll take you right to Grudge Inc.
Mikey is he is off the hook with the technology, ain't he? He's something else. My hat's off to you, Mike.
Yeah, he's okay. For a little short guy, he's all right, you know?
Well, you know, he's short, but he's good. I can tell you that. He gets the job done for us, and he's been awesome.
He booed me and thanked you.
Yeah.
All I got to say to him, I'm going to say it on the website because I can't say it. There we go.
he just don't know me that good. That's all. That's funny.
All right, Carl. Well, I think we're going to end this mess. It's 7 minutes away. Once again, I want to thank Jay Barnes. I want to thank Little Low. I want to thank G-Shot, Kevin Brown from Moroso Performance Products, Chris Matters, Carl Robinson, Mike Fabian. I want to thank all you guys for making this a great show. We'll do it again next week. I'm not sure who we have on next week. I think it's PTE supposed to be on next week. So tune in for that. Duck X will be on next week. He wants to go over his race a little bit. And maybe we can try and get Monty on here before his race and talk about it a little bit. We'll see what happens.
I'm going to plan.
I'll have to give him a call and see what he wants to do.
Let's do it.
All right, there you go. Well, I want to thank all the listeners and callers that were online and all the people in the chat room and all the people listening. I appreciate it. I got Check It Out Nova in there. He better be down at County Line because we're going to do some grudge racing. What do you think of that? You ready for that, Ray? Show
you
up, you and me.
Better get the back tire.
He's got a big old big block with big old fat tires on it. He's got to give me some.
Blog Talk Radio, where millions of hosts and listeners gather.